Krista. Welcome to Teen Say, where teens can have their say and adults can see where they're coming from. Now that we have the communication lines open, let's get started. Today we're doing healthy eating and healthy exercise for families as well as teens and kids. And we have Keel with us from the YMCA. Keel, what's your title here at the YMCA?
I am Member Service Representative and in charge, one of the people in charge of this wonderful Healthy Kids Day.
Okay, so tell us what we have today. I know we have, and we'll get some shots of this, right, Puyon? We'll get shots of the fire truck and the reptiles, lots of stuff for kids' entertainment. Exercise is a form of entertainment for sure, better than just taking your kids out to eat. Wouldn't you agree?
Absolutely. And today we are promoting health with fitness and with diet, with the right type of eating.
Yeah, we're going to talk to the doctors. We have Dr. Chung here from the Change Program and Dr. Bhushan from Ideal Protein for adults. And I think he's going to tell us about teens as well. So tell us a little about what kind of exercise that you offer here at the Y. Is it very expensive? Well, we don't want to talk about money on nonprofit. So tell us a little about the Y.
Well, we are a nonprofit, but we want to make sure that we don't turn anyone away. So in promoting fitness and health, that's what we do. We have people come in and sign up, hopefully as a family, so we can all get healthy together. And we just added preteen programs where we talk about cardio and fat burning. We have children's kickboxing class. We have a little bit of everything, and basketball, swimming, something for everyone.
That's great. Yeah. I keep saying we just need a restaurant where everybody goes and has something to do there instead of going out to eat and just having no exercise. Because I think in Fairfax, that's all they want to do is go out to eat for an activity with the kids. So let's go find out what kind of activities the Y offers. Here with Dr. Chung from the Change Program at Fairfax Hospital, and we're going to ask her what exactly they do at the Change Program. It really helps kids, I think. Okay.
Hi,
hello,
how are
Dr.
you?
Chung.
Hi, how are you? I'm good, thank you.
Can you tell us a little about the Change Program at Fairfax?
Sure. We have a weight management program. It's called the Change Program, which is children with health, activity, nutrition, and good emotions. It's designed for children ages 6 through 18 who are overweight or obese. And what we do is we help these children and their families learn how to lose weight, eat healthy, and exercise. In addition to having a positive, good emotion and being comfortable with themselves, we do this in a multifaceted way over 8 weeks where the children meet with cardiologists, a dietitian, a physical therapist, a pediatrician, in addition to a child psychologist. And by having them meet with so many different people, then they learn all the different things involved that you have to address when you're trying to lose weight and get healthy. And we do this in a fun way so that kids can really enjoy the process, the families really enjoy it, we enjoy it, and it's been really successful and we've been really happy with it. It's open for all children and it's really important for kids to learn, even if they're not overweight, how to eat in a healthy way, and that's what we're doing here today.
How do you qualify to be in the program?
Yeah. It's 85. Yeah, they have to be 85 percentile for their weight for height. So that is the qualification. So a lot of children are about 50 percentile. So when you're at 80 percentile, you're at risk for medical issues due to the extra weight that you have.
So you said they talk to a lot of doctors. So how long does this process take before they actually get started in losing weight?
So we've actually been really pleased. Children have done really well just over the initial eight-week program. Weight loss doesn't happen right away. It's a long process. It's a life-changing process. And so when kids are first starting, they certainly are in the process of learning. And we actually find many of them lose weight during that eight-week period. It's important after they're done, though, that they continue to see their doctors once they're finished to keep checking and following up, because it does take a long time to actually get to the point where they're at a normal weight.
How much do they usually lose?
Sure. Oh, sure. It does depend on the child, of course, you know, but what we found is that several of the kids have lost weight, had a decreased hip circumference and waist circumference, their cholesterol levels have dropped, their risk for diabetes has gone down, and so and a lot of these are measurable changes that we've seen, you know, based on lab works and tests that we've done. We also do exercise testing, so their exercise ability has improved usually by that 8-week period, and we hope that will continue them towards that path to healthiness.
So when kids get obese, would you say the majority of kids that you see, they get obese from, I heard, psychological issues, not feeling comfortable with themselves. So is it, do you have a majority, like is it just from parents not teaching their kids how to eat or letting them eat out all the time because we're very busy, or letting them just choose what they eat on their own? Like, oh, I see you have a picture too. Oh, I want mac and cheese, but we'll talk about that in a minute. Or would you say that the majority is, like I know medications, when kids have allergies, they're on steroids, they gain a lot of weight. So what would you say the majority is of the issues, if there is one?
I think probably there's not one uniform answer to that, because for each child it will be different. We do find very commonly that portion sizes is an issue. So when you look at kids who are eating, and even adults that are eating now, we're eating too much, you know, and typically that's part of the problem. Obviously, if they're drinking sugary beverages or juices, they're getting a lot of calories that way. And so with each child, we do an intake session where we go through their diet, their exercise levels, their home life, their psychological basis, you know, all of those things, because it is so different for each child, and that kind of helps us tailor their treatment a little bit better. And so there's not any one particular reason, but, you know, just sort of generally speaking, it tends to be portion sizes, eating unhealthy foods, maybe like junk foods or sugary beverages, or not exercising enough, depending on the age of the child. Younger kids tend to like to exercise, so usually that's not a problem.
When the kids start exercising, because that's in the 8 weeks, they have to start exercising, how often are they exercising?
So we require that they keep an exercise journal, and during that time frame, they're supposed to record their exercise. Again, because we do an intake session, we actually tailor that to each child. So certainly at least 3 times a week, but oftentimes it's 5 or 6, 7 times a week. But the number, you know, depends on the child. So when we have a physical therapist. Yeah, so 30 minutes to an hour, ideally, preferably an hour every day. It doesn't have to be a continuous hour. It can be, you know, 30 minutes. Minutes in the morning, 30 minutes in the evening. It's more important that the type of exercise, because we want the kids to have aerobic exercise where they're increasing their heart rates, they're really starting to increase their metabolism. So the type of exercise is really important too. I think I failed to mention we have a physical therapist also in the program, and that physical therapist meets with each family and goes through that. And also during our sessions, we teach them how to exercise so they do it in a safe way. So.
When kids exercise, their like diet increases. So how do you like keep track of?
So sometimes when you exercise more, your appetite increases and you might eat more. And it's really a matter of calories in matching calories out. So if you are going to eat after you've exercised, it's important to eat in a healthy way, you know. So going out, you know, exercising and then going to eat fast food probably isn't the way to do it, you know. So as long as it's in a healthy way and you're matching your calorie intake and outtake, then eventually, you know, it leads to a healthy weight. So.
So when you see you're a pediatrician as well. Where is your pediatrician's office?
Yes. So I'm at Fairfax Pediatrics, and we're located in Fairfax and in Centerville.
So when a normal family comes to you, say, to do a physical with their child, how often should the child that's not obese already be working out?
So it's healthy for, depending on the age of the child, it basically looking for 3 days a week at least, you know, but I would say every day a child should be exercising about an hour a day is what's recommended. There's a mnemonic called, right here we have it, it's the 95210 program, and so what this means is that a healthy child should get 9 hours of sleep per night, have 5 servings of fruits and vegetables, limit screen screen time to at least 2 hours or less a day, get 1 hour of exercise every day, and have zero sugary beverages in their diet. And this is an easy way to kind of remember, you know, what would be healthy for my child. Adults, there's an adult version of this that's 85210. So the only thing that changes is the sleep that we need. But so this is an easy way to try to remember, what am I supposed to do? What are my kids supposed to do? So.
Well, that's great. Yeah, we need to know that. But I'll bet you most teenagers aren't getting that amount of sleep. You want to tell us about teenage athletes and homework and how much they sleep?
From
what you judge at Chantilly?
Well, at Chantilly, I play soccer there, and we are out there every day, right after school, for about...
I think it's great.
Yeah, about 2 hours, and then we go, like, home, eat. We just want to go to sleep, but we can't. We have hours of homework, so we're, like, not getting our sleep, but...
But you love it anyway. So, do you want to explain... How come we have macaroni and cheese and chicken nuggets here? Are you promoting this? Or is this what American children are, or these are what Fairfax County kids are eating?
Actually, they are what the children are eating, and it isn't as though those would be my choices, but we really have to go with what are they eating, and this is a very typical, say, a meal out. And so on this side, you see what they typically are given at that meal. This would be the pyramid portion that it should be. So you can see everything is in excess except the vegetables. You notice there's more vegetables on this one. So we really trying to encourage the vegetables for the vitamins, the minerals, the fiber, which helps keep you filled up. But that isn't the most popular item, of course, that the children are eating. They love their mac and cheese and they love their nuggets, so we want them to eat the right portion of them. We certainly don't want every day of the week to look like that, though.
So I'll tell you how we were... do you have something to add, Dr. Chung?
Are some snacks and healthy snacks and just a demonstration of what these are. If we want to hold them up, they're all, these are all.
These can fit sometimes, but we certainly should have the right quantity. It shouldn't be a large package of the potato chips, but a small one. And baked is better. You're absolutely right. They should. This shows. Yes, you have some very good points there. Yeah, very good.
And what we're thinking is mac and cheese, to put broccoli in the mac and cheese or peas in the mac and cheese. And when my son was younger, for the iron, we would tell him those were Ninja Turtle eggs. So he would be as strong as a Ninja Turtle. So.
That's excellent. You're absolutely right. That's very good. For some of the children that are very, very hungry for a snack, you want to go with the very low-fat snacks and things that have a lot larger volume. So this is the 94% fat-free popcorn, and that would have a similar caloric level to a few pretzels. So with the hungry child, or the child has extra weight, we really want to go with something like this. And this actually has quite a bit of fiber compared to most pretzels. Some, however, are whole grain. Most of them are not. The other thing we find is that with the younger children, this is obviously a food for the children. We want to go whole grain. And then on the box, the portion size is actually an adult size portion. Isn't that interesting? So this is actually a half portion of what it suggests to have on the box. So a lot of parents are kind of relying on that information, and it very often, even with a child food, it's an adult portion. So watching that's very important. This is, of course, a good snack, lots of calcium, and children often enjoy this. Good snack. I find that very often with a snack, you want several foods. So it might have a dairy product, might have an orange, and you might have, you know, actually the popcorn for a child who's real hungry. And these together can very often satisfy a child, give them nice variety, opposed to a child coming home, opening up the crackers, and just eating a sleeve of crackers. So, and that's what I find a lot, is that those grains are excessive.
So I guess they need 5 colors a day. Is that still the rule?
Yeah, that's a good way to go. You know, going with that color wheel, nothing wrong with that.
Great.
It's, you know, very often what they have now is the plate method.
Okay.
And so although the plate on the plate method is not drawn exactly like this, I guess we have it right here. This is maybe a better version rather than my drawing.
Okay.
And so you can see that we are advocating the different food groups, you know, in this plate method, the grains, the fruits, the vegetables, the protein, because a lot of people will go very heavy on one of the food groups. It's very often the grains when it comes to children. And so they'll have 3/4 of their plate grain, and then they'll eat a little something else, maybe a little protein, maybe not. And then, of course, they should still have their milk, the dairy.
I have a question for Dr. Chung. So with my kids, I have 4, so I have always preached from when they were young, and that's why I think they're all athletes, is right after school, I would meet them outside because they were tired, but they would need to exercise instead of going in the house. And my husband used to say, well, they should start homework, and I know a lot of people believe that. I just wasn't one of them. They're in school for all these hours, and they're not getting to, I have a couple of questions for you. They're not getting PE every day, which I think they should. Sometimes they have indoor recess instead of outdoor recess because of the weather, which again I think is terrible, because I think they, like in some of the private schools, they'll go right into the gym and they'll have gym time to play basketball or floor hockey or whatever it is they're playing. But what I would do is I'd make them have an hour of exercise either on a bike ride or at the park, and I'd have their waters outside and I'd say, here, have some water. Unfortunately, sometimes I'd give them Gatorade, because what I found is a lot of the kids don't drink enough when they're in school. They're getting one bottle of water for the whole day, and when we're at home, we drink so much water, you know? So they get headaches often. And so sometimes I would give them the Gatorade, which I know then you kind of just want to use that for athletes. But so what do you, I have 2 questions for you, Dr. Chung. What's your theory on, I know a lot of the pediatricians, I know Russell Libby, Dr. Russell Libby was, with a group of pediatricians had gone to the governor for more PE. Can you tell us a little about that?
Yeah. So a few years ago, the Virginia American Academy of Pediatrics, basically as part of a larger movement, tried to get legislation passed that required a certain amount of PE or physical activity every week in school. And it passed the Senate and it passed the House and in our state government, but unfortunately it was vetoed at the governor level. So we were unable to do that. The reason behind it, obviously, is that exercise is good, and many children rely on that PE at school as their only form of exercise. Some children, when they get home, they don't have anyone there that allows them to, you know, to watch them, take them to various games and things. And so many people are fortunate that we can do that, but there are many families who can't do that. And also, they may live in neighborhoods where it's not particularly safe for them to go run outside and play. And so for those children especially, they rely on school PE as their only form of exercise. And so, yes. And the other thing is that often happens in school PE is so much time is spent sort of getting ready for PE, and then if they're allowed free play, like in recess in elementary school, they spend most of their time talking to each other and not actually physically exercising the full half hour that the PE time is allotted for. So basically, many studies have shown that children concentrate better and do better in school if they exercise. So coming home from a long day of school, it's a good idea to let them run around and exercise and sort of get everything moving again before they have to sit down and focus for several hours during homework. So that's a very reasonable and a good idea, especially for some kids. They need that, but all kids should have at least 1 hour of exercise. So if they're not getting it at school, doing it at home is a good idea. And if you can't go outside, you can do it in your house. You can just jump up and down. You can do jumping jacks. You can do hula hoops. There are lots of indoor activities that do the same thing. So if your child's unable to go outside, you know, look for things that your child can do indoors that does the same thing, where as long as their heart rate's going up and they're sweating a little, that's good exercise.
Do you need more PE?
Yes.
Why?
Because it's bad to sit around all day, and kids don't get enough exercise, so it's hard to focus during school and they don't do as good.
Do you think you'd do better if you got to run around more during school?
Yes.
How much longer? Don't say 8 hours.
An hour or 30 minutes.
Okay. Okay, so, all right. Now, what about a place like this where you have the track upstairs and stuff? Would you like to run this on days you didn't have soccer or a planned activity versus staying home because some of your friends might be out at activities?
Yes.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Tell me why.
Because it's better to get exercise than just play games and video games indoors than run indoors.
Yeah, I know you like running up there, don't you?
Yeah.
What do you think of, and of course this is your opinion, but the Wii Sport, is that what it's called?
So any of the nice thing about a lot of the video game technologies is that they've recognized that sitting down playing video games is leading to more sedentary behaviors, which is then leading to more obese people, children and adults. And so I applaud them for incorporating these types of activities where you have to move. So sure, so certainly if you have those at home, they're a great form of exercise. The kids love it because they get to play video games on a school night, you know. So, but it's basically as long as they're moving and physical, that's what we want.
Great. Marissa, can you tell us about Wii Dance Dance? Is that what you guys like to do a lot of?
Yes, we actually play a lot of dance in our house because it's a form of exercise. We work up a sweat, we're just having fun, and we're exercising at the same time. So.
And what about getting the guys to dance? That's really funny.
Yes, trying to get our guy friends to do the dance moves is funny.
And it's competitive, right? The girls are trying to follow the screen and do all the moves.
It's like a competition, yeah. You know it, like dancing.
It's a lot of fun? Okay, good. So, Kiel, during the winter, I imagine less kids get a chance to go outside, or the winter prohibits parents wanting to drive all around in the snow or the ice. I mean, I know we're not in New York, but still here in Virginia, we have some bad weather. Not this year as much. The kids were praying for a lot more snow, but it was still very cold. But tell us a little about, so I love the fact we could just go swimming and, yeah, so are you busier in the winter?
We are, and also in the summer, but in the winter it's nice because you can all come here together and we have something for everyone. We have youth kickboxing classes, we do, and the swimming and basketball, we have something for everyone.
And they can just do whatever they want, like if a basketball court's open and the whole family wants to play basketball inside?
As long as everyone's on the membership, I should put that in. So.
Okay. And the why, yeah, we talked about how it works. Nobody's denied to come in, no matter what their financial status, right? Do you like swimming a lot?
Yes, actually, I do swim team. So is there, like, a way to swim laps without being interrupted?
We do. We have swim team. We also have open lap swimming, and we have dance class. I heard you talking about dance class. We have a Zumba class that is wildly popular, so you should check it out. I'll give you a free pass.
Right.
You too.
Okay. So do you have some questions for Kiel about the Y? And I understand you have a teen program here, too. So is that, well, let's go back to little ones first. So you said summer camp. So unfortunately, some of the summer camp are, you know, not as active as they should be either. So the summer camps, what do they do? Do they stay here? Do they go hiking? What do they do?
They do all of that, actually. And we have indoor camp, we have outdoor camp, we have indoor sports camp, outdoor sports camp, we have travel camp, we have aquatics. Definitely. We have aquatics camp where the children will swim 3 times a day, and it's a great way to get kids swimming and learning how to swim.
Thank you, Dr. Chung, and thank you. So we have have some entertainment here at the Y while we're trying to teach families about exercise and eating right. And before we talk to another doctor, we're going to meet, what's your name?
My name is Rachel Walker. I'm from Reptiles Alive. We're out of Annandale, Virginia.
Can I put this close to you, Rachel?
Yes, you may.
And who is this?
This is Senor Guapo, which in Spanish means Mr. Handsome. He's very, very friendly. He's a tegu lizard.
Okay. He looks pretty handsome.
He's not being rude by sticking out his tongue. He's actually just tasting you. But I promise you don't taste very good to him. He's interested in eating things like tarantulas and snakes and even rotten fruit.
Wow. So do you actually bring these guys out all over?
We did. We actually, the Y had us come here today to talk about rainforest animals and the risks of the rainforest. This is a rainforest animal, so we talked about how he lives in the rainforest and how he survives there and also some of the risks he might be facing.
Ah, do you have a question for her, Marissa? How can she pet?
She may pet him.
Do you want to pet him?
Sure.
Not me.
What does he feel like?
Scaly.
Would you like to feel him, Nick? What's he feel like?
Like sort of like zippers all combined.
Yeah, he's a little bumpy. His scales are almost beaded, so a lot of people say he feels like beads.
Ah, very pretty. He is really pretty. Do you have a question for her about him?
How big is his meals, like, each day?
How big is his meals?
That's appropriate for today.
Question.
Portion control, right?
Yeah, I know. He will eat, actually, as much as he can. So think of him as kind of like a sumo wrestler. So sumo wrestlers want to be big and fat, right, because they impress their opponents. So he does the same thing. These big, fat cheeks, he doesn't have them just to, you know, be a little fat. Instead, he has them to impress the girls, because the fatter the cheeks are, that tells her the better he is at finding food. So he's like the sumo wrestler, and he's a little wiggly right now.
So the girls like the bigger cheeks,
they
huh?
They like the big fat cheeks, because it means he's really good at finding his food.
Okay.
Do they bite?
He can bite, so he could bite if he wanted to. The way I'm holding him right now, though, he can't really turn around and bite me. All of the animals that Reptiles Alive uses are very used to being around people, so they understand that we're not going to hurt them, so he has no reason to bite me. But so, if you wanted to.
So you actually just go out to different places like the Y and educate kids, or can they come to you, or how
no,
does...
No, our facility is not here. I'm going to go on and put them down for just a second.
Okay.
Facility is not open to the public, but we go... Sorry about that. But we do go to all sorts of different public events. And so
what this
tells you. And so we go to schools, camps, fairs, and public events just like this.
Wow, that's great. You're doing great work.
Oh, thank you so much.
You're welcome.
Andrew Wilson actually was... inspiration for the opening of Reptiles Alive, good friends of Reptiles Alive as well, and he does basically what we do, but with fish, which is amazing as well.
Okay, well, thank you. We'll talk to Andrew. Bye. So, Andrew, come talk to us.
Sure. Well, my company, Under the Sea, has been around for about as long as Reptiles Alive, from 1995, and we specialize in bringing in live sea creatures from the ocean. Today, our presentation was about sharks and other fishes, and so I brought a baby shark with us.
Wow. Can we see that?
Absolutely. It's actually in the aquarium over here, but okay. Because our animals are a little bit smaller, we use a projection system. So if you look up on the movie screen, you'll actually see the live shark right up there. I'm going to reach back and actually pick him up so we can see him better out of the water for just a moment. People can appreciate how large he is. So you'll see my hand in there. And if we pick him up just very, very gently, we can see that he's pretty docile out of the water for about 20 seconds. After that, he starts to get a little bit upset. He, of course, needs to breathe the water. While I put him back in, though, I'm going to ask our two helpers here if they'd like to touch the shark. You guys want to pet him?
Yeah.
So what I'm going to do is pick him up again, and when I bring him out, I'd like you to feel him just a little bit towards his tail, a little bit towards his head, because it does feel different. We'll go ahead and gently hold him out of the water for just a few seconds. You can experience what it's like to touch the shark. There we go. And then go the other direction. Excellent. And did you want to feel him real quick? Whoa. Do you guys notice that he feels like sandpaper?
Yeah.
So on a shark, he's covered in special little scales called dermal denticles. They point down towards his tail. As you go with them, it's smooth. If you go against them, it's rough like sandpaper. So Under the Sea specializes in teaching about how sharks are good about the good for the ocean's health. They help the ocean stay healthy by eating sick fish. It's kind of like the Y is good for us. It helps helps people get healthy by helping you exercise, but in a different way. When you go to the Y, you don't expect anyone to eat the sick people working out. When you go to the ocean, though, sharks do eat the sick fishes. That's why they're attracted to blood. Blood comes from injured and sick animals. They will follow that blood trail and eat those animals. That way they stop them from spreading germs. Pretty interesting, isn't it?
Yeah.
Do you have a question for him?
How big does that shark get?
Sure. This species grows 4 feet long. Some species only grow less than a foot long. The largest species, the whale shark, it gets about 40 feet long. Altogether, there's about 450 different types of sharks in the world.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
Were you afraid of going into some of the waters while you were surfing? Because you started watching Shark Week a lot. So do you have any questions about that for him?
Where are most sharks located, Pacific or Atlantic?
There are sharks all over the world. The biggest diversity of sharks is in the Pacific. That's our oldest ocean. But in the Atlantic, there's a huge number of different species. There's no sharks really in freshwater. Some can travel into freshwater for a while, but the ocean is where they're found everywhere. Even under the ice, there are sharks.
How come they attack people? Or
it's usually a mistake. They see us, they think, well, maybe that's a food item. They come up and investigate. They might bump into us. If we don't get out of their way, sometimes they do take a little nibble on the arm and say, well, that doesn't taste like a seal. But unfortunately, a nibble can be bad for us. So shark attacks are extremely rare. Maybe 10 people, maybe 100 people in some years are bitten by a shark. Most of them survive. But on the rare occasion that a shark does remove a limb, that's bad news. But sharks sharks actually don't kill very many people. More people actually die from pigs.
Really?
Yeah.
Pigs?
Elephants.
How?
Cars.
Cars. I'll go with cars.
Yeah, I'm familiar with cars. The pigs, think about the pig farmers. At the farm, sometimes in the pigsty, someone might fall in accidentally. There's some accidents that way. More people die from coconuts on tropical islands, hitting them on the head.
Wow.
Yeah. So we do have a,
not good for the noggin?
No. A lot of people are curious about shark attacks, so they have a facility down in Florida that does investigatory studies on shark attacks, and they've been doing this for over 50 years, and they show that only about 10 people a year are actually fatally attacked by sharks, so it's extremely rare. There are four sharks we tell people never to swim with, though. The great white is the obvious one. Most people know the tiger and the bull shark. The other one's the oceanic white tip. They sometimes do bite people. Yeah.
Whose teeth are these?
That's my mother-in-law's. Oh, no. No. Those are actually a set of jaws from a hammerhead shark. And those are real, and I'm actually not happy having the real set of shark jaws, because that means someone had to kill that shark. So there's one less shark in the ocean. But for people that are curious about how big a great white's jaws can be, I brought a nice model of shark.
Wow.
Here. This is a life-size model, and so we didn't have to kill the shark for these, but it's a nice representation of how big the mouth can be. All right, take a look back there. You'll see the teeth behind teeth. You guys know that we only get three sets of teeth in our lifetime, right? You're shaking your head like yes. Now, you probably don't remember what the third set's called. They're called dentures. Yeah, sharks don't have to buy dentures. They're always making new teeth.
Do you have a question for him about the shark?
How old is the shark?
How old is your shark?
This shark is only 1 year old. But the interesting thing for me is that this species was born from an egg. So some types of sharks lay eggs. This one was born from a little egg about that large that some people call it a mermaid's purse. He came out as a little baby shark, and now he's a year old. When he's 5 years old, he'll be 4 feet long.
Will you keep him then?
I'll keep him, but he won't be able to travel around at that point. He'll probably be in a facility that we hope to open up soon in this area, an aquarium.
Yeah. Very nice, very nice. Any more questions for him, guys?
Thank you.
Thank you. We hope to see you at one of our schools soon.
Thank you very much.
Keep up the good work.
Thank you for coming out.
Dr. Bhushan, nice to see you.
Nice to meet you, too.
See you. We've already told them that Ideal Protein has helped me lose 20 pounds. I still have 20 to go,
right.
But we're happy. I'm feeling better. What do you think of Ideal Protein so far?
I think so far, my mom looks great, so I guess it works. Do teenagers, are they welcome into this program?
Absolutely. Our program is geared towards age group of 14, 15 to 80. I have a youngest one right now in our program is 12, and the oldest one is 84 years old.
Wow.
What about an education just for families to learn how to eat if they're eating incorrectly, like if they want to lose 5 or 10 pounds or just learn how to detox because they're having way too many sugars, way too many carbs, and they want to go through like a detox? Can they use these drinks and these bars instead of like the normal protein bars in the store or the normal drinks?
My goal is that you have to educate children, teenagers, and adults about healthy eating habits. And our program is geared towards presentation of this very comprehensive educational program where we take you inside your body and show each organ how it changes as you're gaining weight. And when you eat a particular type of food, what it does to your liver, your pancreas, your eyes, your joints. So the program is more towards long, healthy life without taking too many medications and making unnecessary hospital visits. So our program is geared towards education. And through that education process, we bring you to what type of foods are right foods for you, particularly for teenagers.
So how many stages are there?
There are 4 stages to this program. First phase is that you reach 100% of your target goal, and we calculate the body mass index and body fat percentage and tell you that this is the goal, get you to that goal. Then phase 2 starts where we introduce some normal foods, phase 3 and phase 4. The purpose of this program is to carry you forward through losing weight and then keeping it that way. The critical part is that we keep the weight down.
Do some people gain weight moving from transitioning from step 1 to 2?
Step 2, patients still will lose 3 to 5 pounds. Step 3, in phase 3, you can gain 5-7 pounds. But in phase 4, when we have gone through this education process, you learn which foods are putting weight on you and which foods are not. And that's what the goal of this program is, that we want to keep the weight where it should be.
So a lot of programs, well, let me give you this first.
Yes.
What is this? Can you tell us about this?
This is 5 pounds of fat. This is more solid, but the weight is 5 pounds. Actual fat is more viscous, like a thick oil, which we store in the middle part of our belly. But this is 5 pounds of body weight. You can imagine if you lose 10 of these 50 pounds, how much weight you're going to lose. So each pound changes your physiology. That's what our educational program tells you. Each pound is important.
You can put that down, Dr. Bhushan. So let me ask you something. Is it true once a person, usually with some diets, as soon as you start eating normally, quote unquote, again, or badly, I should say, if you resume eating and you discard your education, then you're going to gain all the weight back. But how many of your patients usually, like, do, because I know this is nationwide, because I ran out of my foods, and I looked them up, and I actually was in Florida, and I got some of my foods in Florida on my spontaneous trip.
I think you have to understand this. The very food which you are eating got you to where you were. So if you go back to eating the same food, you're going to go back there. Our process of education is that once you know how your body is changed because of what you did, that you don't want to go and go back to that again.
So you won't eat a gallon of ice cream every night?
You should eat ice cream, but it has to be maybe once or twice a week in control. That's what we teach you through the program.
Do you have a question for him about... So I've heard a lot of teenagers say with our teen program that teenagers can eat whatever they want because they're kids and as much of it as they want because they're working out. Right?
Yeah.
Do you agree?
Well, I work out a lot, so I eat a lot. So is that, how does that like affect me? Like,
does she have to detox, like carbs and sugars?
Let me explain this to you. If you look at all the studies which have been done, a typical weight of an individual is dependent on 75% what you eat and 25% with exercise. So you can't replace one with the other. Both have to go in parallel. You have to eat the right kind of food and also exercise with it. Plus, the second thing is that once you're passing through your 30s, your metabolism slows down 10%, and another 5% when you approach 50. So even if you're eating the same kind of food when you're eating when you are younger, you are still going to gain 50% body weight. That's why everybody gains weight in their 40s and 50s. So the exercise has to increase a little bit, and the intake has to go down a little bit when you're in your 40s and 50s.
Things for their friends on their teams. They have like little goodie bags they give each one on a game day, right? Is it on a game day? Okay, what do they usually have in it?
Lots of candy.
What is it called?
It's called a secret pal. So you bring a gift to someone on your team, and you give them all this candy and Gatorades and all this stuff. But
what we have through our education program, it shows that when you eat a particular type of food, how it affects the lining of your stomach, and then from there how it affects your pancreas, how the insulin comes out, and how it changes that liquid fat into the fat cell, and the vicious cycle continues because the cravings increase. As a person gains weight, the fat cells which accumulate in your abdomen, they are secreting these chemicals which are going to your hypothalamus in your brain and increase the craving more. So you're caught up in this cycle that to fulfill that craving, you have to eat more of the same thing. Through our program, what you learn is to re-educate the pancreas and re-educate the fat cells so that you don't get trapped into that vicious cycle.
Okay, any other questions that you think of?
How do the teens do on this diet?
I have teenagers who have part of this program, and they have done very well. In fact, one of the younger men came in. It was a project for his company. He started this project. Now he's writing a paper on this because he has done so well. So teenagers do very well on this program. But the key thing remains that they have to understand the human physiology, how your body is working, and why you're gaining weight.
Can you tell us a little about carbs and sugars? So if an athlete has a bag of Sour Patch?
Yes.
Or a bag of candy?
Yes.
Before the game and a Gatorade. That's a lot of sugar.
That's a lot of sugar.
And so are they going to have more energy, or are they going to crash later?
You need sugar prior to an exercise routine. That is important. But the key thing is that if you look at the natural history of human body, from 1940s and 50s, the typical diet was 35% carbs. And now in 2013, the typical diet is 75% carbs. And that's why we are seeing people are gaining weight, because so much of carbs going in are causing excessive insulin secretion in your body. And that hyperinsulinemia is triggering this mechanism of excessive fat accumulation. So carbs are important, but they have to be important in only 30 to 35% of your total intake.
And sugars, should an athlete be eating candy before a game, or should they be eating an orange or an apple?
I think they should be eating a complex sugar, which is an orange or an apple, which will give you more energy over a longer period of time, rather than eating a simple sugar like a donut or ice cream or chocolates or cookies, because they are simple carbs and they get broken down so quickly that it's like peak and valleys going on, and they're not healthy for you.
So teenagers are kind of moody, right?
Yes.
Do you think that part of the problem with teenagers is they start not listening to their parents anymore, and, you know, like, they're out more with their friends, they're eating more, like they're getting these goodie bags at school, they're going out to eat to McDonald's or wherever, Burger King fast food, they're, you know, all the fun places that they love to go. So they're eating out more, and do you think they're actually having hormone issues that make them moody, in your opinion? I know. Do you think it's the peaks of sugar and carbs?
I think it is both the hormonal changes taking place and up and down, and also the natural human behavior is that you will go for something which is quickly available, it's tasty, and you're not thinking in terms of it is healthy or not. I think the difference is they have to understand what is healthy for them and what is not healthy for them, and that will only come through education.
Do you find that a lot of people use food as a reward? Like brownies for good grades, ice cream for a goal at the soccer game. What do you think of conditioning our kids that food is a reward?
It is a definite problem we have, kind of a good and a bad thing, that you're rewarding someone who has done well, but we're rewarding them with the wrong type of food. I feel it is not a crime to eat cookie or ice cream or donut or something. The key thing is that it has to be a balanced approach, that you have to realize that instead of giving them all candies, they can maybe add a banana or an apple, something which is nutritious, and they can still have a cookie with it. So you have to enjoy life, but it has to be in a educated, healthy way.
And I mean, enjoying something like a balloon, we see the balloons behind us, or something like maybe, you know, if you score 10 goals this month, I'll buy you that model airplane you wanted to build, or something, you know, a toy, or, you know, to earn a smaller toy from a dollar store or something more appropriate than the quick fix of ice cream or a cookie?
I believe that, you know, something educational, something which is more mind-stimulating, will be more beneficial. But if they want to add that with a cookie or an ice cream, it's not abnormal. I think it's okay to do that, because when you are young, you got to enjoy these things also. So a mix of those two things, I think, in my opinion, will work very well.
I'll stick with, I'm going to preach to their kids as a grandmother in the future. We'll get them prizes, and we'll work up towards other prizes. What do you think?
I guess that's good.
Are you going to bake a lot, my little baker?
Yes, I do love cookies and everything, but you got to have it in moderation, I guess.
What about comfort food? How come you think teenagers love to, is it true that teenagers like love to just munch on chips and munch on chocolate and like they're like, okay, I got all the, how do you go to the movies? I got the chocolate milk, I got the cookies, how does that work? Is it comfort or is it just yummy?
No, it's just yummy, I guess.
So Kiel, I guess they have to tie in a lot of exercise with eating right and basically get an education. Start eating right and exercising.
Absolutely. It's not just one thing. So it's everything. It's a complete cycle.
And who should be educating their kids? The YMCA, Dr. Bhushan, who should be educating today's kids with obesity issues?
I think everyone should. Parents should be more involved with what their kid is eating. Yeah, they may not listen, and then the other people has to step in. And it's good to have someone reassure the kids that...
Reassure? Them that, yeah,
their diets are like critical to long life.
I was just going to say that teachers can be educated too, so they would get that information in school as well, don't you think?
Yes. Yeah. And I think when my kids were younger and they had teachers that made them stand up doing testing, SOLs and stuff, and do jumping jacks and stuff, I love those teachers. And you know what? The kids love those teachers, right?
I have a teacher like that. We all do get annoyed from that sometimes because she makes us get up, make some oxygen go to our brain.
Nice.
And
circulating.
Yeah. And makes us focus more, I guess.
Fine, thank you.
So you're walking. I see your cane. Can you tell us a little about that?
Well, I'm a walking paraplegic. I have had a cheerleading accident when I was in high school and dropped from a pyramid and had to learn to walk. And so it got me where I need to really start taking care of myself and really focus on my health because I couldn't walk. So you had to focus on the body, kind of tells you it's in control. And so you have to do everything you can to help it and keep it going. And so I got into the gym and started doing more workout and things. And then about 3 years ago, I had a car accident in work. I work for FEMA and I work in disasters. And so I had a vertigo and crashed everything and that. So I had to, because of my health, because of my shape and because I was taking so good care of myself, it made me heal faster, but I still have vertigo issues. So the cane is really made for balance, for vertigo, because even though we have impairments, it really allows you to know you're not in control as what you think you are and your body is more in control. So you just have to take care of yourself exercise, eat well, sleep, and do all the things you can to keep it going. And so that's why the cane's just helping me for balance, but mainly I work out about 2-3 hours a day.
Wow.
And I keep going, so nothing's stopping me. So.
Very good. Well, you keep it up. Thank you so much for talking to us,
Cindy. Thank you so much. Have a great day.
You too, and I won't push my kids to go to the top of the pyramid, okay?
Yeah, the bases are better. The base is better. Even though flyers are okay, you know, it's just all about, it's all about sequence.
Yes, yes. Wow, you need really good bases to make sure that
exactly.
doesn't happen.
You
wow.
bet.
Was it in college or high school? Oh, high school, you said.
Yes. Wow. Just a couple years ago.
Yeah. Great. Well, thank you so much, Cindy.
Well, thank you.
Take care. Keep
you
up
too.
The good work.
Thank you. Have a great day.
You too. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Well, a teen center is basically a place where kids can go after school. They would like to do some fun recreational activities and get some life skills built up for them if they don't really have anything to do after school.
That sounds great. You want to add something to that?
Yes, we picked them up from the surrounding area schools, middle school and high schools. Bring them here, give them a healthy snack, and we started the festivities after that.
I saw you guys playing some basketball and some dodgeball with them today.
Yeah, that's more so Mr. Joe's problem. You know, he's the athletic guru over here at the teen center, so.
Yes, athletics is my thing, and we just try to have the kids have a healthy, active lifestyle.
That's great. That's what we also talked about at the YMCA, right? We talked about having them have a lot of exercise and some fun activities after school instead of going right to the homework. Do you find that's better?
Oh, yeah, definitely. You know, some kids, when they go home, they just go home and get on the computer and play video games, things like that. We do have video games. We provide them a lot of options here. You know, we have basketball, dodgeball, football, and anything you can do, basically, we can do here at the teen center.
Awesome. Under supervision, right?
Yes, yes. We try to have this place as safe as possible. We always have people managing every room and supervising every room to make sure every kid is playing and having a good time in a nice, safe environment.
So, you come to the teen center to have fun and just get activities
to? Oh, yeah. I just come to the teen center, you know, just to have a great time with friends and also, you know, just better myself in basketball. We have a great staff here, as like AJ or Gerald, that really help and like had real good experience in basketball, so it really helps too.
Awesome. How old are you?
I'm 16. I'm a sophomore at James Madison High School.
So do your friends come here too?
Yeah, yeah. I have a whole lot of friends from school, other schools. They all just come here and we just like play 5-on-5 or like quick pickup games. On Fridays we have like 3-on-3 tournaments. So it's really good for basketball and just meeting new people.
I have a question.
Yes.
So what was I going to say? So what makes you come to the teen center? So you're 16?
Yeah.
So what makes you come to the teen center after school instead of just hanging out at home?
I mean, for me, I live in an apartment now. We just moved, so it's a lot smaller. And now that I'm closer in Reston, I get to go here a lot more. I can just walk here now from my house. And it's a lot. It's really fortunate enough, too, because, you know, a lot more people that go to South Lake that I know, I can see a lot more. And I can come here, too, just to practice basketball like every day, too.
And you're building up a sweat, which is great.
Yeah, I know.
That's
it's
good.
It's embarrassing on TV now.
Yeah. Well, thank you very much for being with us, and we hope that you got a great education thanks to the Y and all the doctors here, and to Marissa and myself. Have a great day, and until we see you next time, eat healthy and exercise.